Diagnosis of the problem. The problem, Muslim clergy were waiting for the divine intervention, thinking that if they are just sticking to the puritan Islam, you know, God will help them, and you know, the British, they will be defeated, and after that they will revive their power and all. Sir Sayyid was a realistic person. He analyzed the situation and he said he was the first person among the Muslims to realize that education is empowerment. He was the first person to realize that education is a panacea for all the problems of the Muslims. But what kind of education then? Because there was already an educational system that we call, that's in Assami, that was there. In India, madrasa system was there. Sir Sayyid said this is an outdated education. He said whatever kind of education we are finding among Muslims and Hindus in India and other communities, they are outdated, they have become outdated, they have become redundant. And it's time to go for Western education, modern education. We should go for Western learning. He tried to develop scientific temper. It was not very easy. And that's why you find the clergy organized itself. Fatwa were issued against Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan. But he never succumbed to the pressure. He established MA College, but before that, he did many other things. First of all, he tried to prepare the community for accepting modern education. And for that, he started Aligarh Institute Gazette with the Ghazipur Scientific Society that was transferred from Ghazipur to Aligarh, and translated many important books of Western learning into Urdu, and said that you should read these books, because whatever scientific developments are taking place in the world, if you are not going to accept those scientific developments, you are not going to be anywhere. Second thing he did was, he started the famous periodical Tehzeeb al-Akhlaq. English name is the Mohammedan Social Reformer. If the name suggests itself, you know, what kind of periodical it could happen. And he adopted a very simple style of Urdu prose. At that time, Urdu prose was not very simple. The people used to use difficult phrases, and the language was very difficult. It was not understandable. Sir Sayyid, you know, adopted a very unique style, very simple language, very simple prose writing, and he started commenting directly. Again, if we say, I know that the words, you know, they change according to the times and circumstances, but you can say that was a radical periodical in the true sense of the term. Radical according to the time. Radical in the sense, because what Sir Sayyid was suggesting, Sir Sayyid was saying that you have to learn from the Britishers, you have to learn their system of education, you have to learn something from them. And the community was not ready to accept it. They said that they are our enemy, we cannot accept anything from the enemy. Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan went to England in 1870. As Raja Ram Mohan Rai has gone to England at the age of 57 years, it is a coincidence that Sir Sayyid was also around 57 years of age. He went to England, he saw Oxford and Cambridge, came back to India and established MA College, Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College, in 1875. And at that time itself, Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan said that I want this college to gradually become a university. This was the dream of Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan. Sir Sayyid passed away in 1898, but he was surrounded by the sincere leaders and the followers. So they tried to realize his dream. And in 1920, Aligarh Muslim University, you know, came into existence. The college was, you know, transformed into Aligarh Muslim University. This college, when it became university, you know, this is not a very small development. Gibb is a very important writer who has written a book, Mohammedanism, a celebrated book. And he says that Aligarh Muslim University is the first modernist Islamic institution in the world. It is the first modernist Islamic institution in the world. And there are people who have paid rich tributes to Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, that wherever Muslims are going for Western education, modern education, they would have started, of course, later. But if they started it in 19th century, that it goes to Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan. So this is the main contribution of Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, that he convinced the community for acquiring Western education, for acquiring modern education. And interestingly, you see that the college was established for, you know, the modern education among Muslims, but the doors were open for all the communities. And the first graduate of Aligarh Muslim University was not a Muslim. He was Ishwari Prasad, a non-Muslim, a Hindu. He was the first graduate of Aligarh Muslim University. From 1875 till date, the doors of Aligarh Muslim University are open for all the communities. And it is the true representative of the cosmopolitan culture, the diversity, the unity and diversity of our great country. You see that the religious and political views of Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan are often discussed, debated. Rajmohan Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Mahatma Gandhi, they all have, you know, considered his religious and political views, and they all have considered it. After that, you know, Mahatma Gandhi has paid rich tribute to Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan and says that he was the prophet of education. Nehru, you all know, the dignitaries are here, the August gathering is here, that Jawaharlal Nehru wanted to instill scientific temper among Indians, and he the father of modern India. He has also paid rich tribute to Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan and said that, you know, he was the man who brought modern education to the country, he was the embodiment of tolerance and all. Basically, when we talk of politics, it was rightly said that politics was not his cup of tea. But we all know that it is said wherever you are, you may not be interested in politics, but politics is interested in you. So this was the case with Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan as well. And it is also said, you know, I am a student of political science. Soltau says that politics is the concern of everybody with any sense of responsibility. Those who are living in democracies, they know the importance of politics. And there are countries in the world where the voting has become compulsory. So, you know, what happened that politics came to Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan also. And he wrote many, many political articles. I want to mention Asbab-e-Baghawat-e-Hind that Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan wrote after 1857. You know, when the colonial masters were constructing truth, a particular kind of truth, deconstructing truth constructed by those who are at the helm of affairs, those who are holding power, is very, very difficult. And that too for a community which is at the periphery, a community which is marginalized, which is peripheralized. Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, you know, credit goes to him for successfully deconstructing a discourse that was constructed by the British missionaries at that time and the imperialists at that time. And he said that don't blame Indians for the revolt. You know, it is why? Because they are not being represented and the British government is not knowing their problems. Since they are not being listened to, since they are not having any kind of access to the Governor General Councils and the representative bodies, so this is the reason that they are not being heard, and that's why this has happened. In 1858, somebody was talking about representation of the Indians in the councils, in the executive council of the Governor General. That's something, you know, amazing. He has studied John Stuart Mill. And he has quoted in the famous speech, the political speech that he delivered in 1882, that was on the local self-government bill. And he quoted John Stuart Mill and said that Indians must be given representation in the all the bodies so that they can ventilate their problem, they can, you know, make aware the government about their problems. Secondly, what he said that he debunked the theory that was developed by the British government at that time that there was a conspiracy by Iran and Russia to remove British government from India. He said this is something rubbish, it cannot be accepted at all. And he said that, the third thing he said, that it is said that right from the time of Crusades, Muslims are inherently against, you know, the Christians. British government, you know, the same kind of divide and rule policy that the Indians do all over the world. So that was done. So he said that this is also wrong. He said that the religion of Muslims is not under threat in India, and that's why it is wrong to say that jihad is incumbent upon Muslim. He was a person who at that time said that India is not, you know, a board of war, it is a board of peace. He convinced his community not to go for agitational politics, not to go for confrontational politics. Because, you know, one of the writers from Aligarh, Professor Ariful Islam, writes in his book that if Sir Syed Ahmad Khan would have followed the path of those who are living in armed struggle, there would have happened only one thing, that in the history books we have got another man as Syed Ahmad Shaheed Sani or Syed Ahmad Shaheed II. We all know that Syed Ahmad Shaheed, he died while fighting against the British. The one more thing, why Sir Syed is a man for all seasons and why he has become more relevant in today's world. Madam Her Excellency from the United States of America, I want to draw your attention. Sir Syed was the pioneer of interfaith understanding, understanding between the communities, understanding between the Hindus and Muslims, the two great communities of our great country, understanding between the people of the books, among the Muslims, among the Jews, and among the Christians. And he was the first Muslim to write a very positive commentary on Bible. And he tried to show, you know, that the Muslims and the Christians, they are not incompatible, they can live in peace, there can be coexistence between them. In this era of, you know, conflicts, religious extremism, dogma, superstition, and whatever we are seeing in the different parts of the world, and when the people are trying to make us believe that there is a genuine clash of civilizations, what is being preached in the Huntingtonian thesis, that you cannot love what you are unless you hate what you are not. In this time of crisis, his endeavor for understanding between the various communities of the world is very, very important, and that must be recalled. We know that erecting a wall of separation between a Berlin wall of separation between religion and politics is very difficult. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan was against developing a political approach to religion as well as developing a religious approach to politics. Both are dangerous. If we develop political approach to religion and religious approach to politics, it becomes very dangerous. And that's why Sir Syed Ahmad Khan emphasized that politics is a domain that should not be guided by the religious zeal. So here we find the element of secularism, the secularism of our country, that is positive secularism, where we pay respect to religion, but the religion is not going to guide the policies of the state. So that's why, you know, that element also find in the writings of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. When Sir Syed Ahmad Khan did all these things, you know, he fought against those people, you know, who were rejecting his ideas, those who were rejecting his movement, those who are saying this Aligarh movement is something that is funded by the British government. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan is the agent of British. He is trying to make us Christian by, you know, putting us into Western education and all modern education. He, you know, did not answer them with any kind of aggressive attitude, because it was not his style. He just did his positive work. He concentrated on his work. He collected money from the people, went to Nawabs and Rajas, and then established hostels, college, schools and all. And meanwhile, there is a very good example that how he hated agitational politics and religious extremism. That William Muir was a person from England who had written a book, The Life of Muhammad. And the book has maligned the Holy Prophet of Islam. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan went all the way from India to England and gave a befitting reply by pen, not by sword. He wrote a book, Khutbat-e-Ahmadiyya, and all the baseless charges that were leveled by William Muir against the Prophet of Islam, he gave a befitting reply. He did not call the Muslims to go for agitation, protest, and he did not call for his head. Rather, he used pain, and by pen he gave the answer, the reply. I think this is something that must be re-emphasized in our time, and that's why he is a man for all seasons and he has become more important in our time. You know, when Christian W. Troll, who has written a good book on, he's a well-established authority on the comparative religions. He's saying about Sarsayed, I quote, "Nobody intent upon understanding the phenomenon of ideological change from the so-called medieval to modern Islam in the 19th century can afford to ignore the religious thought of the Indian Muslim Sayyid Ahmad Khan," unquote. Professor K. Narami, who also was the Indian ambassador to Syria and formerly Vice Chancellor of Ali Bin Muslim University, a well-known historian, he says, I quote, "In the history of India's transition from medievalism to modernism, Sayyid Ahmad Khan stands out prominently as a dynamic force pitted against conservatism, superstition, inertia, and ignorance. He contributed many of the essential elements to the development of modern India and paved the way for the growth of a healthy scientific attitude of mind, which is the sine qua non for advancement both material and intellectual," unquote. Today, we have Ali Bin Muslim University, as His Excellency our Ambassador, you know, talked about Ali Bin Muslim University, which is one of the best institutions in our country. According to Times Higher Education Survey, it is the second best university of India. Basically here, I want to draw your attention towards some very, very important point that, you know, what Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan did was, at that time, that when the Muslims were going for all kinds of agitation and violence, he called upon Muslims to shun violence and become the true representative of Islam in his own words. Quote, "Do not show the face of Islam to others, and instead show your face as the follower of true Islam, representing character, knowledge, tolerance, and piety," unquote. While making assessment of his personality, his services, and his achievements, one is amazed by the profound influence he has on the horizon of South Asia and the Muslim world in general. As a humble and loyal servant of British government, he tried to uplift the status of a community which was completely destroyed in the 100 years armed struggle against colonialism. He tried to awake them from deep slumber, instill scientific temper in them, establish schools and colleges, and the MA college for them, dreamed of the college transformed into a university. His sincere services and sacrifices brought many hard-working people of integrity around him, who were able to fulfill the dream of the founder of the Aligarh movement by converting the college into a university. Spread over 467.7 hectares in the city of Aligarh, Uttar Pradesh, Aligarh Muslim University offers more than 300 courses in the traditional and modern branches of education. The medium instruction in Aligarh Muslim University is English. It draws students from all states in India and from different countries, especially Africa, West Asia, and Southeast Asia. In some courses, seats are reserved for students from SAR countries and Commonwealth countries. The university is open to all, irrespective of caste, creed, religion, or gender. In spite of the establishment of numbers of universities and institutions of higher learning all over the country, this university has been maintaining its national and international character as an institution of excellence. It has more than 28,000 students, 1,342 teachers, and some 5,610 non-teaching staff on its roll. The university has now 13 faculties comprising 107 teaching departments, 3 academies, and 15 centers and institutions. A special feature of the university is its residential character, with most of the staff and students residing on the campus. There are 19 halls of residence for students with 80 hostels. Apart from the conventional undergraduate and postgraduate courses in social sciences and humanities, the university keeps pace with the nation's growth by offering facilities for specialized learning in areas of technical, vocational, and interdisciplinary studies. So we can see that, you know, a man who started as a humble British servant, you know, a movement for the empowerment of a particular community, a community that was not ready to accept modern education, a community that was trying to stick to the traditional system of learning, he tried to develop scientific temper, rational mindset, and what he achieved, you know, that it is one of the finest institutions in the world, and what Gibbs has called, I have already mentioned, it has, you know, what AMU, so it has a visible international character with the students from the different parts of the world, including the Republic of Mauritius. You know, I think the number should be increased. We have around 10 or 15 students over there. And the contribution of the students of Mauritius, you see that how they love their alma mater, that in Aligarh there is Aligarh Bachcho Ka Ghar, you know, that is an orphanage, where there is a Mauritius house they have built up. This Mauritius house catering to the needs of 40 orphan students over there. And that is fully funded by our alumni from Aligarh Muslim University. So, a big hand applause for them. The university is the vehicle of social transformation for Muslims and is contributing immensely in the process of nation building in India. Its alumni and alumna are making important contributions to their societies and countries of origin. Sir Sayyid had visualized in his lifetime that the college may expand into a university whose sons shall go forth throughout the length and breadth of the land to preach the gospel of free inquiry, of large-hearted tolerance and of pure morality. I hope and wish that Aligarhians, wherever they are, will live to the expectations of the founder of their alma mater. Great philosopher, poet Allama, and poet Allama Iqbal had observed about the significant contribution made by the Aligarh Muslim University in these words, I quote, "Few institutions in the history of modern Islam had such deep and far-reaching impact on the intellectual and cultural life of the Muslims as the Mohammedan Anglo-Oriented College founded by Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan in 1875 and raised to the status of university in 1920. It heralded new era of intellectual and cultural renaissance for Muslims not only in India but the whole of Asia," unquote. I hope and believe that Aligarh Muslim University, the custodian of the Aligarh movement, with thousands of its alumni spread across the globe, will continue to uphold the spirit of the gospel of free inquiry, of large-hearted tolerance, and of pure morality. With these words and with six lines of Urdu couplet, I will end my memorial lecture. Aye Aligarh, aye jama kismat dabis tane kohan. Aye Aligarh, aye jama kismat dabis tane kohan. Aye Aligarh, aye jama kismat dabis tane kohan. Aye kishame fikr se tabinda teri anjuman. Tere paimanon mein larda hai sharabe ilm fun. Hashr ke din tak phala phula rahe tera chaman. Mashale meena se roshan tera mehkhana rahe. रहती दुनिया तक तेरा गर्दिश में पैमाना रहे। बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया।